number 180, Al Rushaid versus Pictet NC. Thank you, sir.
May it please the court, Gary Neftalis for the appellants. May I reserve 4 minutes for rebuttal?
You may, sir.
Leave to appeal was granted by this court, asking to review how, in our view, the First Department, the Appellate Division, failed to apply this court's bright line standard found by unanimous court only a few years ago in the Lickey case for determining personal jurisdiction under CPLR 302A1, and also that the Appellate Division failed to address core allegations and evidence showing in our allegations, because after all, we're here on a complaint where all the allegations are assumed to be true, all inferences are to be drawn in our benefit, and indeed that how our allegations show that Pictet repeatedly used its New York correspondent banking relationship.
Is that the operative standard, that it has to be repeated use and that's it?
I would say so, Your Honor, because if you recall the history of Lickey, the Second Circuit had the Lickey case. It was removed from the state court to the Southern District and up on the Second Circuit, and there was some confusion as to what was required beyond mere maintenance of a correspondent banking relationship. What, in addition to mere maintenance of a correspondent banking relationship, would suffice to hold that a foreign bank transacted business and would be subject to jurisdiction under 302A1.
Well, we examined that in Lickey based on the activities of the bank there, which seem to me are very different from the activities of the bank here. In Lickey, the bank had its own interests and was actively using its account to do something that was illegal, to even do what it did, which was to send money to terrorists. And so it had the direct relation. It seems that there are a lot of distinctive features between Lickey and this. And the question is how far does Lickey take us? Not whether, because to me, I think it's pretty clear that this is not Lickey.
I would respectfully agree that this is not Lickey, because I would respectfully submit this is a much easier case for jurisdiction than Lickey. In Lickey, the certified question was, does a foreign bank's maintenance of a correspondent bank account at a financial institution in New York and use of that account to effect dozens of wire transfers on behalf of a foreign client, and I emphasize on behalf of a foreign client, constitute a transaction of business in New York? This court answered that question by saying complainants alleging a foreign bank's repeated use of a correspondent account in New York on behalf of a client, in effect, a course of dealing, shows
purposeful.
I'm a better lawyer than I am a grammarian, I hope.
Time will tell.
I hope so. Shows purposeful availment of New York's dependable and transparent banking system. The allegation in Lickey, which are really kind of important, is that the allegation, if you look at the Lickey complaint, it says in paragraphs 51 and 53, which are quoted in the record of our case at pages 278 and 279, Judge Stein, that there that at all times, LCB, the Lebanese bank, at all times, all transactions carried out in all the Hezbollah accounts were carried out by Hezbollah at the direction of Hezbollah. And between 2004 and July 2006, Hezbollah made and received dozens of wire transfers via defendant's Amex Bank. So this at direction standard, which is contrary to Lickey, which was set up by the First Department, is completely contrary.
Okay, so as I'm understanding what your argument is about purposeful availment, is that there's a money laundering scheme, right?
Yes.
That facilitates that breach of the fiduciary duty. They're stealing from their employers, they're using the vendors to get these kickbacks, right? Am I following you? And they are...
Not only follow me, you're doing better.
Well, we'll see. And then you have a money laundering scheme. And Pictet and C and Shambaz are the money launderers. So now the whole case is whether or not the use of Citibank in New York City is purposeful availment by them in that money laundering scheme. Tell me how they did that. Because that's the test, the purposeful availment. What you're calling this course of dealing is the way you get to purposeful availment.
Well, here you have, mm-hmm. without any discovery in this case, mm-hmm. we've been able to discover 15 bribes that were paid into the correspondent bank accounts and were then transferred at Pictet's direction, because only Pictet can direct the payment out of the correspondent banking account.
Well, this is what I wanted to ask you. So as I understand it, the complaint alleges that the money that goes to Citibank, the correspondent account in New York, is credited to TSJ. It's then divided up amongst these three employees later on, and their accounts are credited. What does that mean, credited?
What it means is this, as the allegations in the complaint say, mm-hmm. Pictet was a central player in the money laundering. Mm-hmm. Pictet, this fellow Shambaz, who was the person, he knew the three corrupt employees for 30 years, was friends with them. Mm-hmm. He knew where they worked. Mm-hmm. He knew about their fiduciary duties to Al Rashid. He knew that they were not permitted to take monies from vendors of Al Rashid.
Okay, no. But this is a exercise of, as I understood your allegation, by the bank of their authority. And I just want to know what that means to credit the account. Does that mean the correspondent account, let's just use easy numbers, a vendor puts in $100 worth of kickbacks, that correspondent account informs Pictet, Pictet credits TSJ 100. Right? That's what I understand the allegations are. Does that mean that the Citibank account now is at zero and the Pictet account is at 100, or does it mean something else? What does that mean to credit?
I think it, once Pictet authorizes the transfer out of the correspondent banking account, it's no longer there. Uh-huh. It's now in Pictet's account. Initially, in the phony corporation that Shambaz set up for them, which was this TSJ Engineering, which was a fake, mm-hmm. which was used as a conduit, and then first there, in that phony company that was set up by Pictet for the corrupt employees in the British Virgin Islands, and then transferred from there to individual Swiss bank accounts that Pictet had set up for the individuals in Switzerland. And what Pictet is alleged to have done here at the complaint stage mm-hmm. here is obviously be a central player in this scheme. And why, in response to Judge Stein's comment, I mm-hmm. took a different view than Judge Stein's initial question was, let me tell you the difference between this and Lickey. In Lickey, what was the real harm? The real harm didn't occur in the United States. The real harm occurred in Israel. Because what happened in Lickey, the allegation was that the alleged terrorist organization, Hezbollah, was killing innocent Israeli civilians, i.e. the plaintiffs or relatives of the plaintiffs who were killed or injured. But they were all killed or injured in Israel by the Hezbollah terrorists.
Was it your argument? Is it your argument that here it's Pictet's, because Pictet knew about this bribery scheme and enabled it, so to speak, that that's what gets it past just being a passive transfer? Because we've said that merely having a correspondent bank account isn't enough. And as you describe it, whenever there's a correspondent bank account, the foreign bank has to be the one to direct money from that account to somewhere else. So in that view, then Three Amigos would be meaningless, because any time there was a correspondent bank account, there would be direct action directed by the foreign bank, and in your view, it would be long-arm jurisdiction, right? Purposeful availment.
Well, I think that, most respectfully, I think you may be reading Lickey a little too narrowly.
Well, I'm trying to figure out where the line
is. Well, the line is this. The line is this. What Lickey was talking about, or this court, your court, was talking about in Lickey, was when is something purposeful as opposed to a mistake? In other words, if something happens once, and that's language in Lickey, about they talk about not being a mistake. If something happens once, it could happen by accident. It could happen by...
Isn't it a little different? Isn't it to show purposefulness, you have to look at them on a continuum? So on one end, you've got Lychee, and on the other end, you've got Amigo Foods. One transaction doesn't show a purposeful pattern of behavior. Lychee was dozens, right? So in Lychee, there was purposeful behavior, and that shows that this seems to fall somewhere between, on that continuum between the two of them.
Well, if you look at...
In other words, it's not three transactions get you in. No, that gets you jurisdiction. It's not the way it works. We have to look at the whole thing as a continuum and to see... And to see if it was if there was enough there in the record. Here we have 15 transactions, and we have to determine whether or not that would constitute purposeful behavior.
Answer to your question and getting back to something Judge Stein said to me, 15 transactions involving $4 million worth of bribes. Why I say this is an easier case than Lickey and why it easily fits within it, here, as I was saying, the primary wrongdoing in Lickey occurred in Israel because the killing of the people. The financial assistance to it was secondary. Yeah. Here, what was the principal violation? The principal violation was a breach of fiduciary duty by the three corrupt employees to our clients. And where did that happen initially? The payment of the bribes occurred in New York. It occurred at the correspondent bank. At that point in time, the breach of fiduciary duty was proven. And Pictet was central to that.
But isn't that going to the second prong of the statute, the articulable nexus, and not the first prong, which is what we're still talking about?
I think that the first prong is a much lower hurdle. The first prong, and that's what Lickey was saying, if you look at the Second Circuit follow-up opinion to Lickey by Judge Sack, at some point, if you do enough, you're subject to the jurisdiction. And certainly, we would suggest that we plainly have a better situation than Lickey on the first prong. Secondly, on the second prong, which I think is really easy in this case, because the second prong acts as a bit of a shield, because if there's no connection, no relationship, no articulable nexus, as Lickey says, between the transactions and the tort or the violation, then you wouldn't have long-arm jurisdiction. Here you have it because the bribes themselves are the wrong. Here it's an easy case on the second leg, Judge Rivera.
Counsel, I'm sorry, Chief, may I ask one question?
Yes.
In the files, so if you split it that way, one and two, doing business in New York and then the nexus, right?
Yeah.
So you have a bank, Zurich Bank, they have a correspondent account at Citibank, and they do 10,000 transactions through that account a day. Are they doing business in New York and meeting the first prong?
I think they are meeting the first prong. If there was no connection whatsoever,
but
they wouldn't be meeting the second prong.
Right. So just on the first prong, you're not looking at 15 transactions related to this specific, to the nexus question. You're looking at how much business are they doing in New York through their correspondent account?
I think what we have in terms of our record and our evidence here is we have 15 corrupt transactions. 15 corrupt transactions.
Right.
Which we think is of the same family as dozens of corrupt transactions in Lickie.
I guess my question is, do you need them to be corrupt transactions to meet the first prong? Or if you do enough transactions in your correspondent account in Citibank in New York, are you doing business such as to get by the first prong of the jurisdiction?
I think they don't have to be corrupt transactions to get by the first prong of Lickie.
And then the second is nexus between X number of those transactions and the alleged wrong in your complaint.
Yeah, yes, Judge Garcia, I would agree with that.
Thank you, counsel.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Ms. O'Connor?
Good afternoon, and may it please the court. Maeve O'Connor for the defendants and appellees in this case. Before I jump into Lickie, which I've been calling Lychee this entire time.
So
me too, so it's okay.
Okay,
keep calling Lychee.
I feel better. So before I jump into that, I do want to say that the picture that Mr. Neftal has painted of this elaborate money laundering scheme masterminded by Pictet, this case has traveled a very long way through the successive rounds of briefing and the lawyers' argumentation and the rhetoric from the complaint and from the documents attached to the complaint. And this was a motion to dismiss that was initially decided by New York Supreme based on a complaint that says one thing about correspondent bank accounts. It doesn't say they were the center of a huge scheme. What it says is that the corrupt employees caused, you know, the vendors to pay money and instructed them to pay it through these correspondent bank accounts. That's the allegation in the complaint on the correspondent bank.
Yeah, I think
bank
we're
account.
Familiar with the complaint, so okay. Let's now get to purposeful availment. So can you clarify for me what does it mean to have credited the account in Switzerland?
Well, I mean, again, there's nothing in the complaint on this, right?
I understand that, but I'm asking you, what does that mean?
Right. Well, as a technical matter, I'm not,
yes,
frankly, entirely sure how, yes, how the crediting works. My understanding is the money gets wired into an account that's held in the names of these individuals in
Pictet would approve this transfer, this wiring, or this crediting?
I didn't hear
is
the
Is that correct? Pictet must approve it?
Your Honor, I'm sorry to say that I don't know the answer to that question. I don't, and again, there's no proof on that. We've heard assertions on it. So
this is a motion to dismiss. We're assuming the factual allegations.
There's no factual allegation on this, Your Honor, at all.
There's no factual. They say you credited it.
They don't allege that.
Are you saying that's not a factual allegation?
There's no factual allegation, I believe, Your Honor, that Pictet affirmatively took an action to cause the money to be wired into Geneva.
I believe they say it's credited, that you credited it.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I don't want to. I don't have that allegation specifically in front of me. I can look
okay,
for it.
Okay. Going back to the complaint, doesn't paragraph 38 lay out this conspiracy theory among the employees of the bank and the corrupted employees? And it seems to me what the allegation is, accepting them as true for jurisdictional purposes, is the corrupt employees got together with Pictet, and I have to remember I was calling it Pictet, but Pictet bankers came up with this way to get the money to the Virgin Islands, and part of that was setting up this company in the BVI, but the allegations are that the insiders in the bank were part of that. So it isn't Amigo, certainly, where it was the bank sends it to the corresponding account in New York when it could have sent it to Maine. And isn't it more like Lickie, where the allegations in the complaint, and I've read that complaint, were Hezbollah was allegedly directing the money into the New York correspondent account. The allegation, and I think it was Judge Stein who was getting at this earlier, that to me seemed to make the nexus, was that the Lebanese bank itself was part of the scheme to fund Hezbollah, and that using the accounts in New York, which Hezbollah was directing the money to, furthered that scheme. And isn't that analogous to this, where the allegations at least are the bank was involved for whatever commercial purposes it might have had, in helping these employees hide the money, those employees, like Hezbollah, used the correspondent account.
Your Honor, I don't believe it's particularly analogous at all. I think that Leakey is a different case, and I think they make some kind of extraordinary arguments, actually, trying to get jurisdiction here, to the effect that repeated use is the standard as opposed to purposeful availment.
But let's look at nexus to the crime, which seems to me the appellate division saying it was the corrupt employees, let's call them, who directed the money to go through the correspondent bank, which seems to be making an analogy to Amigo. But what's different to me about that is, one, Leakey wasn't the bank itself saying, there's no allegation that I can find in that case that the bank itself was directing the funds through its New York correspondent accounts. In fact, the only thing in that record I can find is that Hezbollah was allegedly directing the money into the New York correspondent bank. So I have a problem with what the appellate division was saying was the distinction here, that the direction came from the corrupt employees rather than the bank. That doesn't make sense to me, especially in light of those two cases.
Well, I'd be happy to address that, Your Honor. I think that the language of the decision by this court certainly seems to suggest something other. The allegation is that that the clients requested that money be funded, but not that the clients requested that money be funded through New York. And what this court stated is, while it may be that LCB could have routed the transactions on behalf of Shahid elsewhere, the fact that LCB used a New York account dozens of times indicates desirability and a lack of coincidence. And this is very significant. I think the court was focused on an act of choice by that bank to actively wire the funds to New York, to reach out to New York, to choose New York as opposed to Miami or someplace
else. How do you square that with the language in Leakey from all the documentation below, and I think even in the circuit decision referring the question to us, that it's Hezbollah who directs the money to go through the New York corresponding bank?
Well, I don't know how to exactly square those, but it's the opinion of this court that's the law, and so I'm just reading this quote, and that's what we were
based on. I don't think we ever actually say the bank directed it. We say something about the bank's motives for using a New York correspondent account; it may be cheaper, but I think you could also read Leakey to say the use by the bank of the corresponding accounts in New York really went to that the bank was part of the crime, as alleged. So the bank is using its accounts in New York to further the improper purpose, and that's the use of the bank, of the New York accounts, not that LCB, I think it is saying, use our New York corresponding accounts.
And that's not the way I read the case, Your Honor, but and I also think that Leakey was further different in that the act of the wire was the wrong. So the bank is alleged to have shared a goal, and this court said that the wrongdoing occurred when the funds were wired. In this case, this is a case against a bank. The alleged wrongdoing occurred 5 months before anything was wired in Geneva.
But it's a conspiracy allegation, right? At least in part, there's two count charges. So one's a conspiracy that the bank was part of aiding and abetting or conspiring, I guess are the two counts, to breach fiduciary duty by these employees. So if that's an ongoing crime and part of that conspiracy is to launder the money into the British Virgin Islands, how is this not under our nexus analysis of Leakey part of that?
I actually think that issue is a huge problem for the plaintiffs, and here's why. The whole thing is an aiding and abetting claim, right?
So there's also a conspiracy claim, isn't it?
There's also a conspiracy claim, but the claim is that they aided and abetted the breach of duty and that the bribes are an essential part of that payment. But this is essentially an attempt to hold the bank liable or subject to jurisdiction based on the conduct of others. Because they're saying these other people caused these funds to be wired
way. No, they're saying the conduct of others is the conduct of your bank employees. It's the right. Bank being part of this. The bank has the corresponding accounts. The bank, and these are the allegations, set up the British Virgin Islands company, and then the bank is part of this, and the corresponding accounts are being used. I think those are the allegations.
Their claim, as I said before, is that you're the money launderers and you facilitated this breach of the fiduciary duty for the clients, these employees, and that you're completely active, that this is not a passive role. You're not sitting at the bank and money comes in and out of your accounts and you're unaware of it. They alleged particular factual assertions about what Pictet and C did, as well as Shambaz and the whatever it was, the eight board members, however many it was. And I'm just finding it very difficult to understand your argument when their assertions on a motion to dismiss, just on the face of the complaint, is that that is the active role, and that that role only makes sense with respect to the correspondent bank if indeed you are approving the use of that bank. Money goes in, you credit it somewhere else, and that that's part of the money laundering scheme, and that's essential to the role that you played vis-a-vis the claims that they assert, the aiding and abetting and the conspiracy. That sounds to me like purposeful availment. I'm not understanding your argument.
Okay. Well, that's not good news for me. So I'll make one more attempt.
You have
then
time.
And then I'll move on to another argument. But I guess our view is that it's very different from Leakey and different from other purposeful availment cases. Because in Leakey, the bank was actively wiring money out through New York, choosing New York and wiring it in that direction. In this case, the bank is, funds are coming in. The actual allegations against the bank pertain to a meeting in Geneva 5 months earlier.
But then if your view of Leakey is correct and we accept it, why don't they get jurisdictional discovery to see if there's any correspondence or communications indicating that what they allege are the insiders at your bank, your client's bank, are involved in directing the money through New York since they set up the Virgin Islands shell company?
Well, I think there are two reasons why they don't get jurisdictional discovery. The first is that Mr. Niftalis said to Justice Scarpula, we don't need additional discovery.
Now, what he said was, I don't need it. It's my fallback.
Well, I think I was there and I heard it the same way Justice Scarpula did, and I thought to myself, okay, we're not going to have that argument. And I don't think you can say that to a court and then turn around and say, I'm going to appeal your ruling because I was entitled to something I said.
So it was in the motion. It's an alternative argument.
Yeah.
It may very well be you don't want to undermine what you think is the strongest argument on that oral argument, but it's in your papers.
Yeah. But secondarily, I think the other reason is because there's no need for it. Judicial efficiency does not make sense to the parties to engage in a whole lot of jurisdictional discovery.
But you're saying
when this
it's
case
their
is subject
missing
to dismissal.
Piece.
I'm sorry? You're
saying it's their missing piece, that they don't have the bank in any way affirmatively directing this money through New York or taking an active role in the choice of the correspondent account. And why wouldn't they be entitled to do a limited amount of discovery to see if you actually did that?
Because the case is subject to dismissal as a matter of law under this court's decision in Mashreq Bank and under the United States Supreme Court decision in Sinochem in 2007, you can address forum nonconvenience prior to addressing personal jurisdiction. Forum nonconvenience is a ministerial decision that a court can make and should make in a case where otherwise the interest of judicial economy would be disserved by undertaking expensive jurisdictional
well,
discovery.
Well, you're not suggesting
for no reason
that we should make that determination, are you?
Well, I believe this court absolutely can make this determination.
Isn't that a highly factual, discretionary balancing of a whole lot of things?
Well, this court could not make it as an act of discretion. I would agree with that. As an act of discretion, the lower court would need to address it first, and this court would review it for abuse of discretion. But this case, I believe,
here we would have nothing to review for abuse of discretion because no determination was made. Right?
That's correct, because this is one of the unusual cases where the decision can be made as a matter of law. This case, if you march through the sort of key paragraph of this court's decision in Mashreq Bank, which identifies that case as an unusual case in which forum nonconvenience could be decided as a matter of law, the court said, apart from the use of New York banks to facilitate dollar transactions, a fact which we've said is of minor importance here, we see nothing in this case to justify resort to a New York forum. No party is a New York resident. It's also the case here. No relevant conduct apart from the execution of fund transfers occurred here. That's also true because, as I've said, the claims against Pictet will turn on conversations in Geneva. They won't turn on the fund transfers. No party has identified any important New York witnesses or New York documents, and the key word there is important because the standard does not as articulated by this court, no party can, by scratching their head, identify any conceivable New York witness. Even in Mashreq Bank, there was alleged to have been transfers through a New York account, and in fact, there was alleged to have been a fraudulent transfer from one New York bank to another. There would have been some New York witnesses, but they were not important witnesses in the case. There's no property related to this dispute that's located in New York. The question of related litigation. The plaintiffs have tried to sort of bootstrap their way up here by filing some other cases in New York.
Counsel, I know you want us to take a different action, but I want to stick to what's before us right here about whether this is under Leachy or not.
Okay.
And, you know, I think that part of my concern about the appellate division's decision is they never once used the term repeated. And that was something that we mentioned in Leachy. Repeated banking activity shows New York transactions that are in fact purposeful. And the appellate division never even used the word repeated, although there are 12, 15 transactions here. So what does that tell us?
Well, I think the word repeated, the way I interpret it, I'm obviously speaking to the authority on the meaning of the case, but the way I interpret it is that it was used in that case as sort of as a proxy for purposeful availment. And combined with other factors, such as the sense that comes through from the decision of an active choice to use New York. In this case, there's deposits made through that account at the direction of third parties that are received by the bank. And I think the court felt, in my view appropriately, that was not indicia of purposeful availment by PicTech, but rather was something more passive. And I'm not aware, to be clear, of any case in which this court has found personal jurisdiction based on the sending of deposits only through a New York correspondent bank account. I think that would be, I'm not aware of any case.
It's wiring the alleged bribes and kickbacks, again, with all factual allegations, right, to Citibank, the correspondent account, which is then credited elsewhere. And as he points out, you got to prove that. So again, I'm trying very hard to appreciate your argument, but I'm really not fully understanding it.
Okay.
It's very hard to appreciate what I think is the essence of your argument, which is vendors just put money in that account and they ended up in Geneva, and we don't know how that happened.
Well, I guess I would say this, Your Honor. I think that this argument that just receiving funds through a correspondent bank account is very much akin to mere maintenance of the bank account. Because merely a bank that merely maintains a bank account, if it's the case that they need to take action to cause those funds to be wired, they're doing that all the time, but that's not enough.
But if it's used for the purpose of this laundering enterprise, it's not merely we deposit it there and somehow we decide it'll end up in Geneva at some point or another, but it's part of, again, it's their allegations.
I appreciate that
it's part of this enterprise.
Right, but
doesn't that make that different from just, you know, somebody's putting deposits in my account?
I don't think it does, because again, I think their claims against PicTay are about a meeting in Geneva 5 months early. That's what those claims against PicTay are about. Did Pierre-Alain Chamba know or did he not know?
But the allegations are that these are deposits and it's a kickback scheme that's over years. Are you taking the position that this is all like one day later? The 15 transactions are all one day later?
One day later.
After the
meeting? I'm not understanding.
Well, as I understood the complaint, was that this is over years.
I'm not taking the position that it's
certainly
all one day later.
Sounds like a course of dealing over years?
Well, I think our point would be that the case against PicTay, this is a foreign entity. The claims against it are going to rise or fall, not based on whether funds were transferred through a correspondent bank account. It's incidental. They're going to rise or fall based on testimony by people who, by the way, can't be compelled into New York. These corrupt employees can't be compelled into New York by anyone present here. So it's going to rise or fall based on testimony by them and by Pierre-Alain Chamba about what was discussed and was there a conspiracy and was there that's what it rises or falls on. The transfers, you know, they say they're bribes, we say they're not bribes. I don't actually think they've properly alleged much of this stuff that is now spread all over their briefs, but in any event, this is not the core of their complaint by any stretch. I don't think there is a real substantial nexus to what needs to be proved by burdening completely foreign parties to speak in their not native tongue about claims that you know pertain to something that took place in Geneva. There's a perfectly adequate forum available in Switzerland, and I don't think that there's any point in burdening the parties further with judicial discovery. I see I'm out of time. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. O'Connor. Mr. Naftalis?
Can I ask you a question about the discovery? You made a request for a discovery, but in response to the motion to dismiss, were there any affidavits or anything of a factual nature submitted to the court to asserting or providing a basis to say that there may be facts that would be revealed and how to assist you in establishing jurisdiction? I mean, isn't that what you have to do?
In connection with the motion, we filed, in addition to the documents we filed, and they're in the record beginning at 209, a series of exhibits to an affidavit of mine. I think they're exhibits C through I, and they are at the record beginning at page 209, which are the instructions to the bribe payers to pay to the correspondent banks.
Okay, but that's your evidence of this. But did you ever say that we think that there may be other forms of it? That's the evidence you do have. Did you ever say this is what we think we might be able to get? That's with the case law clearly says it has to be more than speculation and all that. Did you provide anything to the court to support your argument that jurisdictional discovery would be necessary and appropriate here?
Yes. Well, we didn't put in an affidavit. We did put in our briefs the kinds of questions.
I'm talking about at the trial level.
No.
Okay.
I think we did that in Supreme Court, not here. I can check that to be sure because I don't want to misrepresent. But obviously, the discovery and just so it's clear, I wanted to clarify one thing on the discovery while I'm answering your question. The notion that we gave up our rights to get jurisdictional discovery, I mean, that's just not correct.
Do you see any limit to this? Your rule is that if you have an account in New York, you're subject to New York jurisdiction.
No, that's not our rule. The rule is the rule that your court, that this court laid down in Lickey. And what the court, and I want to get back to Judge Stein as soon as I finish.
Right, forget
this. No, I don't want to forget. I want to answer both questions. What was happening was, particularly in some Southern District of New York cases, the courts were all over the place trying to figure out if just simply having a correspondent banking account isn't enough, what more do you need? And they posed the certified question to this court under the facts of Lickey, which we would respectfully suggest are not dissimilar to ours in any way in terms of the core root.
So you think that's the rule? If you fall within what I keep calling Lychee,
I'll call it Lychee, it's okay.
Then you're fine. If not, you're not.
I think that rule, because if when this court was dealing with it, they were trying to set up some kind of bright line test.
Right.
We don't want to take jurisdiction when it's like in Amigo Foods. It was a one-time, unintentional thing which didn't even happen. And if it's once or twice, and the court even in Lychee said that if it's once or twice by mistake, that's not what we're looking for. We're looking for something, and we think repeated conduct indicates, I'm sorry, repeated use is a nice bright line test. And I think that's where the appellate division went wrong. They didn't even cite the standard. What they did was almost like a re-argument of Lychee, because they were the same, they weren't accepting the allegations as true. They were trying to carve out some passive exception, which of course is inconsistent with the actual facts of Lychee.
Well, that's why I asked you the question. A passive exception doesn't sound like a difficult thing to me. If pick any bank you want in the world, if there's a correspondent with the New York bank that's they don't know anything about, that's passive, we get jurisdiction. We all of those cases come to New York.
No, I don't know. I think if
you just said they were making a passive exception.
If in fact I'm a foreign bank and I have a correspondent bank in New York and I don't do anything, period, there is no jurisdiction there. The long arm, you're not transacting business. If you engage in repeated transactions there,
the bank.
Yes.
Not employees, not depositors. The bank does.
Yes, but the bank, Judge Pigott, acts on behalf of its depositors. That's why I think there was some mythology in the appellate divisions. A bank doesn't act for itself. It acts on behalf of its depositors, its customers. That's what they were doing in Litchi.
Well, I think if the bank knows that they got a terrorist and they're trying to assist a terrorist in getting money and they use a bank in New York, there may be something to be said about that.
I agree.
If, on the other hand, they say to Citibank, you know, we'd like to set up a banking thing with you because we got people that travel back and forth between us and them, and the people that are using it are doing whatever they're doing. Maybe you don't have jurisdiction over the bank, because otherwise you're saying just having the correspondent bank makes sure.
Yeah, but just as indeed even in the latest Litchi or the Litchi, the follow-up Litchi opinion after this court certified to the Second Circuit and Judge Sack wrote, I mean, the New York courts have an interest in not having the banks being used for either terrorism, money laundering, which is what we have here, or the like. I think it seemed to me if those are your allegations, and they are here, and they are allegations supported by evidence, which I, even without any discovery, we have these 15 bribes. And obviously, if we got discovery, we might discover a whole heck of a lot more. And what I said, just so it's clear, at page 271 of the record before Judge Kafnick, Justice Kafnick, when she first heard the argument before she got elevated, after arguing why we had jurisdiction, it's our view that we don't need additional discovery. I think we have enough here. We just add that as a fallback argument. And I think we have plenty here to show that the jurisdiction. So we weren't withdrawing it. We were saying we think we have enough here without jurisdictional discovery. But if this court felt that we didn't, without, we certainly have made a sufficient start.
Can we decide the forum non conveniens as a matter of law?
I'm sorry?
Can we decide the forum non conveniens as a matter of law?
Oh, I wouldn't think so in this case for two reasons. Number one, Mashreq Bank was, as this court said, a rare case. A rare case. There was one unimportant transaction in New York. And indeed, in Mashreq Bank, as you would recall, the original plaintiff said it ought to be dismissed on forum nonconvenience grounds. This was a third-party claim by the defendant. And in addition, in Mashreq Bank, there had been two levels of discretion exercised before it got up to this court. Supreme Court there had made a ruling which said saying forum nonconvenience applied. The First Department reversed that ruling, and then this court reversed the First Department. So there had been review there. And in addition, just for a minute or two, since my friend here argued it, this is hardly a case. There's so little showing here. I mean, I think it should be remitted as if they want to continue to press this issue, it should be remitted so there's an exercise of discretion to be reviewed. But this is unlike any forum nonconvenience motion I ever heard. There was no affidavit from them with a list of third-party witnesses who would be available in Switzerland.
But if the allegations are true, exactly as you state them.
Yes.
And all you've got is this account in New York and nothing else. Why isn't that an appropriate basis to rule as a matter of law on the forum non conveniens?
Well, for a number of reasons. One, that's not all we have. There is an affidavit in the record that we submitted to Judge Scarpula. I think I can get you the record site, where we had pointed out other witnesses, for example, and connections to New York. For example, the individual plaintiff, Rashid Al-Rushaid, maintains an office in New York. Secondly, two of the critical witnesses that we have, Dr. Ibler and Ms. Medler, who at that time ran an investigation firm called Stratix Capital. Their principal place of business is in New York. They're the ones who discovered the fraud.
These are your experts.
They're not experts. They're fact witnesses. They discovered the fraud. Now, they're not hired experts. Indeed, although this is not the record, Dr. Ibler is now the CFO of ARPIC, and he maintains office in New York. In addition, there are the witnesses and documents from Citibank and the other financial institutions which are in the evidence we submitted, HSBC, Merrill Lynch, Deutsche Bank, all of whom were involved in the transactions here. Thirdly, in the United States, there is a lot of United States connection. First of all the bribes from all the bribe payers that we have discovered so far were paid in New York, and the principal bribe payer is a United States company called NOV, which is located in Texas, who would be susceptible to discovery here and would not be susceptible to discovery in Switzerland. In addition, there are a number of pending actions in the commercial division against four or five of the bribe payers. So you have the issue of coordination, which is a factor. And as I said, they had made no showing there are any non-party witnesses in Switzerland. Obviously, that's where they come from. That's where I assume they'd like to be. And in addition, there's also a disconnect between the kind of discovery and process you get in Switzerland. There's no real discovery there. There are no depositions. You will never be able to get the testimony of, here you could get testimony, obviously, of people in New York, but also like the third-party bribe payers, we could get a commission before a state Supreme Court judge to take a deposition and the like.
Thank you, counsel.
Thank you very much for hearing me.